Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for coming out this afternoon. We're very excited to have you guys. I'd like to first introduce our founder and chief executive of the Simeone Foundation Automotive Museum, Dr. Fred Simeone.
Welcome, everybody. You can't imagine how excited I am. As far as I'm concerned, this is the all-star meet. This is going to be the all-stars of all-stars. I can only introduce the stars, and the stars will talk about themselves. Of course, the real star here is Willy. Willy Riggs, you know about. Ribs has been in racing since he was a boy. He's been in every kind of racing you can think of. He succeeded, created some controversy along the way. You're going to see some clips about a very popular movie that was written about him. And I encourage you all to go onto Netflix and see the whole thing. Obviously, we couldn't have you here for the whole thing, but you get a taste of it. And that was produced by, among other people, Adam Carolla. Now, Adam Carolla is a name you probably are familiar with. Both from his podcast, his interest in cars, and his unrelenting and endless opinion about anything, whether it's politics, sports, or whatever. We are hoping, because his schedule is really tight, that he'll be in here to really communicate with Willy as well. My hero of a longer time than either Adam or Willy is a guy named Ed Welburn. And Ed Welburn is just the superest, nicest guy, but he brings to this table a talent. Ed, as you know, if you know his name, was head of global design for GM. Global design was 10 studios around the world. Ed created that. Ed created that from when he was a little boy, went to the Philly car show, saw a car that turned him on, wrote a letter to GM. Believe it or not, they answered him, and he stayed and stayed and stayed until he became head of global design and made for himself a wonderful reputation designing, among other things, Corvettes, great cars. So I feel close to him because he's been a friend of the museum and he knows more about Willy and he's lived through the Willy ages. So he would like to question Willy and see what he feels about his career. So, Ed?
Well, good afternoon, everyone. When I got up this morning, I was thinking, early this morning, I said, I'm actually going to meet one of my heroes, Willy T. Ribs. I mean, I have known about him, read about him, followed the car magazines and seen the race results and all that for many years. I can't stand still, I'm sorry. I am that excited about actually meeting. Then I get here and Fred asked me to, you know, why don't you ask him a few questions, interview him a bit before Adam is here. I said, well, okay, sure. Yeah, I'm going to interview. You don't often get a chance to do that, to ask questions of someone you've looked up to, someone you've heard about, you've read about, you've got questions and I got a chance to do that, to spend time and ask questions of Mr. Willy T. Ribs, someone who has had an amazing career, amazing career. The man is quite a few years younger than me. I can't imagine how he got so much done in those years, you know, from racing in Europe, to Trans Am racing, to NASCAR, to Indy, the whole Indy experience. I can't wait to ask you questions about that, about all of it. And at the basis, man must have had a very strong family behind him to make him the person that he is today. So with no further introduction, I'd like for all of you to greet Mr. Willy T. Ribs. Are the mics on?
Yeah.
will get said here. I'm not sure if the mics are live or not. But seriously. Where do we start? Do we start by talking about racing or your childhood? I mean, you are, to do everything that you have done and to have the strength to do it, you must have had a very strong childhood, some guidance from family members or friends that are at the basis of it all. Tell me a little bit about
that. I was blessed. My family, actually, my grandfather moved to California when he was 21. And in fact, around 1920. And he left Louisiana. His father, my great grandfather, did very well in business. He had a timber company. He had a lot of land. He had about 20,000 acres of timberland that he lead. That one of his businesses was cutting railroad ties. So he had railroad ties that he sold ties to the lumber company. Plus, he leased the sharecroppers. And so my grandfather and his brothers were sort of, you know, they worked in the family business. They moved to California, and actually they were on their way, him and his brothers were on their way to Hawaii, and they stopped, took the train out, and they stopped in Oakland, California, and they were preparing to get on the boat to go across, and they liked it there, so they wired Felix Beck back in Louisiana and told him that I think we're going to stay here for a minute before we make any other moves. So my grandfather ended up moving to San Jose. Well, all he knew was agriculture. And so he didn't want to do agriculture in California, and he met a man who taught him the plumbing business. And my grandfather, see, these kids today, it's just amazing. The entitlements that they think that everything is easy. He worked for room and board for 2 years just to learn the business. Room and board, right? And he learned the plumbing business. Well, 5 years later, the man who taught him the business ended up working for him. So my grandfather founded Henry Rip Plumbing in 1927. And by the time World War II was over, the business really took off because the GIs were coming back from the war in California. You know, the building boom took off, especially in the Bay Area. And he did real well with his company, but he was no nonsense. I mean, we were working. When school was over, we came to the plumbing business, and he had us stacking pipes and fittings.
I think that kind of explains quite a bit.
I didn't want to work in business. I wanted to be a race driver. And my dad, my grandfather ended up retiring and leaving the business to my dad and uncle. And he bought a 300-acre ranch up near Sacramento, California. And so on the summers, I had a choice. I could work in the family business during the summer or go up to the ranch. Well, I wanted to go up to the ranch, so I could drive Henry's equipment, right? He had harvesters, and he had tractors, and he had trucks. But you worked all day before you did anything. So he was no nonsense. You were told what to do, and you did it. You didn't ask questions, and even digging a ditch, we were 12 or 13 years old, and we were digging ditches like this deep now, and he would walk up to the ditch, and if it wasn't dead straight, he'd point to it. He wouldn't say anything, he'd just point. That man would fix it.
Yeah, I think it explains quite a bit. It explains a lot. Now, in your early racing career in Europe, I'm very interested in the time you spent in Europe driving Formula Ford. You were very successful. I mean, you know, right out of the box, it seemed, as far as I know.
Well, I got asked by the media, why didn't you start your career in the United States? And to this day, I still get that question. Well, I wanted to be a Formula One driver. My dad, the family business was successful enough where my dad could buy race cars, and what he did, he bought Lotuses and Elvas, and so he raced in SCCA. So I started going to the racetrack with him. Actually, he was racing motorcycles before I was born, and I started going to the racetrack when I was around 3 years old. And in Monterey, California, Laguna Seca, Stockton, Katahdin. So, you know, I knew what my, you know, where my career path was going. Well, once I got out of high school, I told my parents, I said, because I spent 3 years on the ranch, you know, student body, 75, whole student body, it was school, high school I went to. And when I was done with high school, and I went to two different high schools, I finished off in San Jose, I told my parents, I told my mom, I didn't tell them both, I told my mom, I said, I want to go to England and start my career. And the reason why is I knew I wanted to do Formula One. I knew that that would be the best place to start. Emerson Fittipaldi. And I was going on Emerson Fittipaldi's playbook. He left Brazil in 1970, and he went to England, and he won the Formula Ford Championship in his first year. And then he got picked up, and he was with Lotus at a very young age. Colin Chapman got him, and I thought, okay, that's the way I want to do it. So my parents sent me to England.
You were on a mission.
Yeah, well, I knew exactly where I wanted to be in my life at a particular time. At that age, I wanted to be Formula Ford champion, and I wanted to get it done quick. I didn't want to spend a lot of time there. Let's get Formula Ford handled. Then we'll go to Formula 3 or Formula Atlantic, and then...
And how old were you when you had that kind of drive, that kind of mission that you're on?
Well, I left the United States when I was 21.
Okay.
So, I mean, I wasn't a baby, but I wasn't ready for the rocking chair either. So, that was pretty much the game plan, and it.
And you spent what, two years?
2 years in England.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And my first race, I finished third, and the team I was racing for, they bumped me up into a newer car for the next race, and the next race I won. It was a wet dry race. Half the race was in the wet, other half was in the dry, and I ended up winning the race, and I knew right then, I said, okay, I can win. And that was it. Once any driver wins their first race, they know that they can do it again, and you just keep the hammer down to do it again. My fourth race was at Brands Hatch, and Michael Rowe and Nigel Mansell and I, all the top Formula Ford drivers were at that race. It was my fourth ever race, and into the paddock walks Bernie Ecclestone and Gordon Murray. And they walked up to me and they introduced themselves. Well, I know who you are. I know who you are. And he said, well, we're watching, because there had never been a driver of color, black,
right,
that ever won anything. And so the news was getting out, so Bernie, they were there to see Nigel Mansell as well and watch us race against each other. Well, as it turned out, Michael Rowe, Irishman, who did very well in his career, won it. I was second, Mansell was third. And that's how we met each other. We met each other on the back of the lorry, as they call it, over there, and they paraded us around the track with our laurel wreaths around our neck. And then I saw Bernie later him and Gordon as they were leaving, and they said, keep up the good work, we are watching. Well, just those words meant that whole trip.
Well, exactly. I can't even imagine how that felt.
Yeah. That whole trip was right there. So.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's great. So once you're finished there, you came back to the States, and what form of racing?
My parents notified me that you've got four other siblings that we have to put through college. So your college money's over, son. So I came, I flew back home, and I met, I think Bernie was responsible for introducing me to the Long Beach Grand Prix Association, and they put up the money to put me in a Formula Atlantic race at Long Beach. That was my first race in the United States.
Well, you got some very amazing connections, but it was your ability that was a huge part of it. You never would have been able to make those steps without the fact that you had an ability as a racing driver to win.
When you're young, and I look back now, my mindset and the way I think now, as opposed to then, I never felt or feared failure. I don't want to deal with my grandfather, but he wouldn't put up with that at all. He was a very hard man, and he was very tough. He was a great businessman, but he did not tolerate failure. And so, I didn't want to not succeed on my own, but that started the ball rolling. And it took a while to when I came back from England, it was 1978. I didn't become a pro until 1983. I was running the Formula Atlantic off and on, and I did real well on occasion, but I didn't run a full season. It was just...
And as a pro, you were driving what? Was that Trans-Am? Trans-Am.
And that was because of Paul Newman. Newman made that deal. And he called me. Actually, it was 2 days before Thanksgiving in 1982. And he called, and my mother said, Paul Newman called for you. And I said, are you sure? He said, yes. And so he's going to call back. So be by the phone. So he called back, right? One thing about people, whether it's Roger Penske or Paul Newman, when they say they're going to do something, it is that. When they say 6 o'clock, not 6:01, right?
Yeah.
And he called straight up at the time that he said he was going to call back, and he said, hey, kid. And I had met him before, prior to that, so we were familiar with each other, and he says, I've got a deal for you. It's not Formula Atlantic, which you've been doing, but it's a Trans-Am, it's the Trans-Am series, and it's a first-class team. I recommended they hire you, and he said it was sponsored by Budweiser. It's a team out of Portland, Oregon, and I'm not doing any favors for myself because I'm going to be racing against you. But I recommend you do it. I've sold the deal. The deal's done if you want it. So he said, you're going to get a call from St. Louis in a couple of days. The guy's name is Jack McDonough. And if he gives you any shit, tell him to kiss your ass and call me. That was Newman. Newman was right, he didn't mince words. He was funny as hell.
I mentioned that I've been a big fan of Willie T. Ribbs. I want to call him Mr. Ribbs. Of Willie. Can I call you Willie?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
You're not that much older than me. I'm 66.
I'll be 71 in a couple, in a month. But anyway, back in, I guess it was the 80s, you were driving Trans Am, right? So I'm just a mid-level designer. I wasn't a big-time executive or anything. And I'm walking through our shops at Design one day. And in the shops where they build all of the concept cars and you know, the secret vehicles and all of this, special plate, is a race car. I'd never seen a race car in there. And it's got Budweiser on the side. And it's got the name of this driver I had never heard of by the name of Willy T. Ribbs. This is my first encounter with you, was that day. They never, ever had a race car in the design shops, but they were in there fine-tuning the, not the engineering side, but just making the car pristine, polishing it, cleaning it up, getting it all ready. I don't know what it was for, but it had Willy T. Ribbs written on
they
the side.
They had my car in there, not David Oz, my teammate?
Willy T. Ribbs was the name on the car. Budweiser.
Well, I'm glad they had it in there trying to find some speed. I mean, they were shaving that thing down.
They were just polishing it, making that thing, you know.
Really?
Yeah, touching it up, getting it ready for some show. Yeah. It's the first he's heard about that little story.
Well, there's a, you know, as a driver, you're, Dan Gurney, when I was racing for Gurney, and this was in 87, 88. A lot of things happen and drivers don't know about it. Changes in the car, you know, and Gurney was very secretive about what changes that were made that he wanted someone to know. Phil Remington, of course, knew. Phil Remington, by the way, designed the, him and Shelby, and they were one of the designers of the GT40, right? Well, Phil Remington worked for Dan. And he was on the technical side, and all that is in a room that's locked, right? Well, when I was racing for Gurney, I would have a conversation with Gurney. I'd make sure, oh, by the way, you know, as soon as we get this new piece, and I would describe the piece, and he looked at me and he said, how do you know that? I said, am I supposed to know? And he says, no, you aren't. And I said, Dan, I got spies and snitches everywhere. And I had to have that. I when you race for different teams, a lot of things happen. And some, and your teammate might get one thing that you don't get. Well, Bobby Unser taught me. He says, find out what's happening. And get someone in there to find what's going on so you you know what you know what's going on. But Gurney and I, he said somebody's going to get fired. So he said to me, well, wow. He said, well, whoever your snitch is, get fired.
There's a lot you have to learn about on track, and then I guess off track there's a lot to learn as well.
It's very
You must have a million stories, off track stories.
Oh yeah, no, there's some that are good to talk about and some not. But.
Well, you know, we're all friends here, we're pals. So Trans Am, you ran Camaros, Corvettes.
I never ran the Corvette.
You never ran the Corvette.
I was fired before I got before I raced it.
Oh, well, tell me about that. if you can.
Oh yeah. 1983 was my first year with the Atlas team, the Budweiser Camaro. Well, when 83 was over, which was the final race was Las Vegas. Caesar's Palace. I won the race, and the next day, Diablo says, can we have breakfast, the owner? So we met for breakfast, and he says, we're going to go to Camaro's, and hello, Adam Carolla. He said, we're going to go to Corvette's, and we think it's going to be good. General Motors is full bore on top of it, the design team. Well, the very first race was Atlanta, Road Atlanta. Well, I was second quickest in qualifying. David Hobbs was behind me and Brasfield. We had three cars. And in warm-up, Sunday morning warm-up, I got into a banging match with another driver, right? Right. And when we came into the pits, after warm-up, I went down to his pit, and I knew we were going to have problems before we had problems. So I banged him on his helmet and left and walked back to the pit. Well, the team manager got into my face about it, and I said, well, I'm just trying to save this plane. You know, because he put me off the racetrack about 180 miles per hour at the end of the long straight at Road Atlanta. And so he fired me.
Ooh.
So they covered up the car. The media was everywhere. I got, I left the track and went straight to Hartsfield Airport in Atlanta. Flew home. On Monday, the phone rang. And it was Michael Kranefuss from SBO Special Vehicles and Edsel Ford. They were both on the line. And Michael Kranefuss was German, or his German,
yeah,
was still alive. Willy, we knew there was going to be a problem. We saw it coming in the last year that you and the team manager could not get along, and we were just waiting for this to happen. And so I have Edsel Ford on the line. Would you discuss with him, with Edsel, what you might like to do or come to our team? So, well, Willie, we know you can win, and we knew we're going to give you everything that you need to win. It's going to be run through Jack Roush, and at the time, Roush had no sponsor. He had the cars, but there was nothing on it. He said, we were going to bring Motorcraft, one of our brands, and it's going to take 6 weeks to get the car down. And would you do it? I said, yes. He says, we have a ticket for you to come to Detroit tomorrow. So on Tuesday, I was flying to Livonia, or Dearborn. I was flying to Dearborn, and we did the deal. They took me to, we signed the contract first. Before they let me into the factory, into Roush's building,
yeah,
I had to have this contract signed. You know, because I,
right? Right, right.
So we went to his business and saw what his shop and all the cars were being built. And the dyno, when I walked in there, the engine dyno was running, Roush, and he was just possessed about,
yeah,
horsepower and reliability. So we met the team, flew back home on Wednesday, and done deal. So, but it took 6 weeks to get the car down. In the meantime, Herb Fisher was running Chevrolet Motorsports. He called Michael Kranefuss and he says, word has it that you signed Willy T. Ribbs. Oh yes, we think he's going to be good for us, and we think it will work. You're making a big mistake. And the reason I know that, because Kranefuss called me. He says, Herb Fisher called, said we're making a big mistake. Yeah, we'll talk about that on Victory Circle. And so after the first car was done, my first race was Detroit. Along with, we were on the card with Formula One. Formula One was
downtown.
Yeah, downtown, and we were the undercard. And I ended up finishing third. I got no testing with the car. Went right into the, jumped in the car, ran the race because they had just completed it. And of course, all the brass was there, and we were 1, 2, 3. We beat Chevy. Mm-hmm. Gloy won it. Bickett was second. I was third. And Don Peterson was there. Yeah, Red Poling, all the big heavy breathers,
yeah,
were at the race.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, yeah. Ford's world headquarters was right there,
yeah,
at the time. Yeah.
So the second race was 2 weeks later in Daytona, and I won. It was the Paul Revere 250. I won that race. Then the next race after that was Brainerd, Minnesota, and I won that, right, back to back. So I get a call from a writer named Bill Mitchell. There was a magazine called All On Track Magazine. I don't remember if anyone remembers On Track Magazine. But I get a call from him, and he says, can I ask you a question? And I says, it's on record or off? He says, on record. He says, rumor has it that you got that you and Ford purposely planned to get fired so you could come race for Ford.
That's a good story.
Oh yeah, no, that was the rumors out that I had planned. I got it and got myself fired so Ford could hire me. And I said, so that's what's going around? I said, well, I'm not going to confirm nor deny. And I left it. Yes, right.
Yeah, you just mentioned three very different tracks. Detroit, Daytona, and what was the other one?
Brainerd.
Minnesota. What were your favorite tracks to run on?
Any one I want.
I like that.
Any one I want. And the fast tracks, I mean, Roush made horsepower.
Yeah.
Right? And, we were good aerodynamically, but Chevy couldn't match the power.
Yeah.
And, if, for example, at Daytona, we were coming off that bank in that Trans Am car about 187 miles per hour, which was pretty stout, right?
Yeah.
The thing was not the most aerodynamic piece on the planet.
Right? Oh, it was a brick.
Right. Oh, yeah. Got a barn door going through there. And then at Brainerd, Minnesota, at the time when I ran it, it was a 1 mile straight. 1 mile. You came onto the drag strip, and it was a medium speed corner coming on. So you were coming on you'd come on about 80 miles per hour, 85.
Mm-hmm.
By the time you got to that, you could eat a sandwich that straightaway was so long.
It's like the Molson at Le Mans.
Well, I mean, not quite that long, but I mean,
but it's long. I mean, a mile.
Oh, yeah. 1 mile. And so you could sort of sit back and, you know, look around and, you know, you're up to top speed. So, see, and what I would do is I would, like, get with someone and see, I'm watching them in the mirror the whole time to see if I could gap them, right?
Mm-hmm.
All right. And you look in the mirror and you see that person behind you gets smaller and smaller. Well, at the end of Brainerd is a sweeping right-hand corner with a tiny bit of banking. It might have had, I don't know, 6 or 7 degree banking, right? But it was, on a new set of tires, you could run through there flat out at 190 miles per hour.
You're kidding.
Flat out.
You're kidding.
And I wanted to, you know, you couldn't do it once the tires started to wear.
Mm-hmm.
You had to breathe it a little bit, sort of breathe it as you were driving in, and then roll it back on the exit, right? Well, in qualifying, I said, okay, we're going to run flat through here. And I went through there, and I was supposed to be training a driver, a Canadian driver named John Jones. And he was our third car. And so Charlie Seelig's team manager says to me, he says, John's having a little problems with turn one. I said, what's the matter? He said, well, he doesn't feel comfortable. I said, have him follow me. yuck. So in qualifying, I told him, we're going to build up. I said, we're going to get up to speed fast because I want to keep the tires good, right? I want to keep, we're only getting maybe 2 or 3 laps we can run flat through there. So we went and warmed up the second lap. First lap by, I'm watching him and he's there. Well, the second lap, I said, it's get down time now, son. So we went down and we smoked in there. Next thing I know, I look in the mirror as we exit turn one, I see dirt. Plumes of dirt in the air. Right?
Yeah.
Well, he didn't get through it, right?
Yeah, that would be me, probably.
Right.
Yeah.
And so qualifying's over. Meanwhile, I put it on the pole and I mean, we were about a second half faster than anybody, and including the Budweiser Camaro. That's all I care about.
Okay.
I didn't care about anybody but them, right? So I come in to get out of the car, and they're repairing John Jones's front end. I mean, the gurney flap on, not the,
yeah,
I mean,
the lid on the front litter.
The splitter?
Yeah.
Oh, it was gone.
Yeah,
right?
Of course.
I mean, he was harvesting corn out there, because there's corn out in the distance. Well, he got out to the corn, right? I mean, corn cobs flying through the air. I mean, it was hilarious. And you know, as a driver, I could laugh during the race. And Wally Dallenbach used to piss the hell out of Wally Dallenbach. He said, "How come you laugh?" And he said, "You should be concentrating." I said, "I am. I am. I don't laugh at all, you know, the whole time."
Right, right.
And so after I get out of the car and Selig says, "Why'd you take him so damn fast?" I said, "That's what you asked me to do." He said, "But he can't, he's not going to do that yet." And, but the track was fast and fun. And I've always liked fast tracks like that.
Yeah. We got to get to Indy. I'd really like to get Adam up here. But one question before we get to Indy. Have you spent time on simulators?
No. No, I've never done a simulator. I tried it one time, and I got asked about that. You know, the last time I got asked, it was before this SRX season that was this year.
Yeah.
SRX Superstar Series. And media called one guy from doing an interview. He says, "Well, a lot of drivers are doing simulators, you know, for the tracks they're going to run on, because we were all running short ovals, half miles." He says, "Do you run a simulator?" I said, first of all, this is when Bobby Unser was alive. This was before he passed.
I knew Bobby, yes.
And I said, first of all, I said, if A.J. Foyt and Bobby Unser found out I was on a simulator, they wouldn't talk to me anymore. And second of all, I said, I don't have a sex simulator, let alone a racing simulator. Well, they printed it. They quoted that, and
that's brilliant.
So, you know, but I could never get it. It just, you know, sometimes you're doing this and your eyes are going one, the screen's dropping one way and your eyes are going, I couldn't work it. Hello, Adam Carolla.
Hi, Willy. I don't know if my mic is hot.
You got to push it. Push a button, I think.
Test one, two. Oh, thanks, Willy.
Welcome.
Yeah, my pleasure. This is just serendipitous because I was doing a couple of shows in Baltimore last night. Got a show tonight at the Keswick Theater. And so the timing just turned out perfectly. So any excuse to say hi to Willy.
You know, I was asked about the title of the film, Puppety. You didn't ask me up here, but when we were down
talked about
the film and how we created Uppity, and your reaction, you and Nate Adams' reaction when I said, "Oh," because we were in the room, and for the audience that heard the story, we had already started a production. I was in L.A. at the studio.
And obviously you two knew each other quite well by that point.
Enough to be able to, well, almost enough.
Well, I always knew of Willy, because I was a fan, racing fan. And so we did the Paul Newman Racing Doc, and so we had to get Willy into the Paul Newman Racing Doc, and then when we were interviewing Willy, you know, the way documentaries work is it's not that much of a science. You sort of, you pick one subject, then, you know, the next one kind of comes in. So when we were filming the Paul Newman Racing Doc, Willy was all over that, and then we're like, oh, that guy deserves his own documentary. So, and he was so engaging in that documentary that we thought, okay, he needs his own doc. And of course, I've known about Willy being a driving a race car fan. So I was like, oh, he needs his own documentary as well. But sorry, go ahead, Willy.
Well, maybe I should tell this story. So we had already started in production. I mean, we were in England doing filming with Bernie Ecclestone. We were Nate Adams.
He's my partner. Yeah, by the way.
Yeah, he's a partner. Adams' partner and director and producer. So we're in the offices in L.A. It's about 11 o'clock at night. Just the three of us, Nate. And Mr. C and myself, and they both looked at me at the same time and said, "Yeah, better think about it. Have we thought about a title? Just offhand, thought about a title." And I looked at them and I said, "Oh yeah, hold on to your ears, folks," because I said, "Uppity Nigga." And Carolla and Nate Adams looked at me. You ever see a deer in headlights when you're driving down the road? Two deer, right? And you got four eyes, right? And they turned and they said, and then Adam puts his head down, so he holds his head and he says, "I don't know if Sharpton would go for that." I said, "Oh, well, what about Uppity?" And he said, "Well, let's think about it a while." And the meeting was over after that. Everybody, okay, let's get up. Time to adjourn. But
I think Uppity is perfect.
Yeah,
it's perfect, right?
Well, that was me. That was what NASCAR called me when I went down to do NASCAR in the late '70s. When I returned from the South, I had a tag.
Yeah.
All right. I had a tag. And it was still smoldering when I left.
Oh, they still haven't forgotten.
Oh, yeah.
They still haven't forgotten. I know. And I'm sure this audience, most of this audience, has seen the documentary. If you haven't, you got to watch it. You got to watch it tonight. I've watched it twice.
Okay.
I'm probably going to watch it again.
Just so you guys should know, we're doing a documentary on Dan Gurney that we're underway on, and starting on one on Bobby Rahal as well. So just for the race fans in the crowd, yeah, good, right? You guys deserve a doc. I've worked a lot in Hollywood and done things. Been there and done that, but I never really thought about making documentaries. And I'm just a guy from North Hollywood, California. I grew up in the San Fernando Valley. I worked construction. I was a boxing coach. And it wasn't really like guys like me didn't make documentaries, but it was, I made a documentary about Paul Newman, and I have 13 Newman cars, and I drive his cars, and so on and so forth. But I made the documentary after Newman had passed away, and then we made Willie's doc, and Willie's still alive, everybody. So it's kind of nice to make a doc about someone who's still alive, just get to hang out with him. We got to hang out in Indy together. He comes to L.A., we hang out. They're thinking about making this thing into a feature on Showtime or a series on Showtime. So if you're going to make a doc, make it after someone who's alive, get to hang out.
You have some Paul Newman race cars?
13.
Do you have the Cutlass?
I have two Cutlasses.
I designed that race car.
You did?
I did.
The V6 or the V8?
I designed the body. I designed the body, not the engine. You know?
So the whole thing about, so there's a Cutlass Trans Am.
I can't
right? Trans Am Cutlass, there's two of them.
Yeah.
So I have both of them. So they had one was sponsored by, one spot, a hotel that doesn't exist anymore in Manhattan. I don't think of the name of it. Billy probably remembers racing against it. The other's a Budweiser. No, one's Pepsi. One's got a Pepsi livery.
Pepsi.
And the other's Rigo Royal Hotels. And so the thing that's funny, and I've raced both those cars, the thing that's funny about the Paul Newman, so Newman went from Datsun or Nissan, he went to Oldsmobile Cutlass at a certain point. So the thing that's funny about it is they're Oldsmobile Cutlasses, but they're Trans Am, they're two-frame Peerless chassis Trans Am cars, right? So if I tell anyone I have an Oldsmobile Cutlass race car, they go, oh, my grandma had a Cutlass. What color is it? And then I go, it's just not really a color, it's just a livery. And they go, the interior of her car was beige, and she had like a cloth velour interior. And I go, it's not that Cutlass.
I think they all have velour too.
Yes, it's not your grandmother's Cutlass. But every time I bring up
Oldsmobile
Cutlass,
there's a little secret about it. And the way we could cheat it, the rear wing could not be any further back than being in alignment with the bumper. Mm-hmm. So I designed a cheated bumper that was an inch further back than production, so the wing could get back further.
On the straightaway, no one ever picked up on the cheated that extra
rear bumper. What are you looking at me like that for?
I'm just thinking about what NASCAR would have done to you with you cheating like that.
Well, that same bumper was used in NASCAR, too. They never knew.
Yeah, I have both those cars. As a matter of fact, one of them was driven by Walter Payton. You know that story, right?
Very well.
Yeah, so Walter Payton drove one of those cars for one of the seasons, and then Newman actually bought one of the cars and owned it personally, and then he rebodied it to a Camaro because they thought, it'll be cooler as a Camaro than it would be as a Cutlass. So he drove it just sort of in amateur stuff as a Camaro body, but I put it back to your Cutlass body.
Okay, so you talk about Paul Newman. I want to hear about Ali and your association with Muhammad Ali.
I was racing when I was in England. It was 1977. And it was during the summer, one of the motorsports journals knew that, I was a fan of his. And he said, well, Muhammad Ali's coming and we'd like to get a picture of you and him together. And Ali was staying at the London Hilton downtown, right in London, across from Hyde Park. Mm-hmm. So, I told the writer, I said, well, I'm going to meet him in the hotel. Well, I kept figuring out, how am I going to do that? So I came that night about 11 o'clock, and he actually came in with his wife, and I froze. I couldn't believe I was actually looking at Muhammad Ali.
Yeah.
And in a flash, he was in the elevator and up. Right? I thought, oh, man, blew down my ribs. So I went to the front desk, and that's back in the day when you could go to the front desk and you could inquire. So I said, in a very American accent, I said, the champ, he runs in the morning, doesn't he? Oh, yes, he does. He comes out about 6 a.m. And she was really nice. I said, well, I'll be running with him in the morning, so I just wanted to make sure I was on time. So I said, well, what am I going to do until 6 a.m.? So I went to Soho in London, and because I didn't want to go back home. It was, a train ride and all that. So I went down to Soho in London, partied, went to this jazz club, Ronnie Scott's, listened to Dizzy Gillespie till about 4 a.m. So it was over. So I took a cab back to the London Hilton and I waited in the lobby. And sure or not, at 6 o'clock. There was no, the lobby was empty, and I heard these the whoosh of the air. And so I turned and looked, and there he was in a tracksuit. Tracksuit and army boots on. And he walked by me, so I jumped up and I sort of followed him out the revolving door. And I said, hi, champ. How you doing? I said, can I run with you? No. I said, hey, I waited up all night to run with you. Well, you shouldn't have done that. And we're walking and talking. And so he walked, and I followed him. He says, okay, you're going to run behind me. I said, okay. So we started running, and we ran for about, 5 or 10 minutes. He didn't say a word. And he says, you from America? I said, yes, sir. What you doing over here? I said, well, I'm driving race cars. Was a young black boy like you all the way over, drive a race car? You could do that in America. I said, well, I'm going to be a Formula One driver. So he says, you ever get scared? Now we're running. By then he let me run next to him. You ever get scared? I said, you ever get scared of Joe Frazier? He stopped right on and turned around. No, I'm knocking you out. Don't you ever see Joe Frazier? Don't. And he was jabbing at me. And so we kept running, and we got close to the road, and one of the big triple-decker buses, the red ones, they saw him. The bus stopped, and people ran off the bus. They knew, they recognized him. And so we finished up running, and he was, same time he was telling me, he said, you're going to have to be tough. They ain't going to like you. I come from Kentucky. They didn't like me, and I'm in boxing. So if you're racing well, he didn't know it was NASCAR, he just said stock car. Stock car racing, they're going to try to kill your black ass. Just remember that. I mean, you must be tough. So we were done, and we walked into the hotel, and I was ready to say goodbye. And he says, you hungry? I said, yes, sir. Well, come on up, sir. Up with me. You can have breakfast with me. Amazing. Up to the 20th floor, and that was it. He wanted to know about driving. And he said, you think I could be a race driver? No, you're pretty big, So, but that's how the relationship started, and right up until I went to his last marriage, I went to his wedding. In fact, I took Robbie Unser to Muhammad Ali's wedding in 1986. And
that's the most unbelievable story. I mean, it's a great story. I love that story. I mean, I'm a big fan of Ali. And, growing up, I'm just a couple years older than you, but as a kid growing up, there weren't a whole lot of heroes that looked like me. There weren't a lot of heroes of color. And Ali was the man. And I just looked up to him, and he just made me, I felt 6 inches taller just because
of everybody that way. It was amazing. When you were with him, today you see athletes, they walk by people, they blow off the little kids. Kids want an autograph, they walk right by him. Muhammad Ali was just everybody. He gave everybody time. And little kids, I mean, he was always picking up kids, but I never saw Ali walk by someone and not say hello if they said hello or ignore him. And he just made you feel like you were special. Incredible.
You've got to talk about Indy before we leave. I don't know how much time we have. Willie T. Riggs.
More questions. We're going to get some stuff cleared up. First of all, Humpty Wheeler is a bit of
100 miles per hour going the wrong way in Charlotte, I'd still be in prison now. Actually, what happened was I was looking for a gym. There was a gymnasium. Well, I was going down a one-way street, and I turned into the wrong driveway. Was on the wrong side. And I had actually passed the gym. So I went out, and rather than going down around the block, I went in a 45-degree angle down the wrong way and turned in. Well, the cop saw me. And he said, you know, I'm ticketing you for going the wrong way. I said, but that was really not the wrong way. So he says, well, technically it is. So I hand him my driver's license, well, it was a California license. And he said, well, you're gonna have to follow me down. When you're out of state license, you have to go and post bail and pay for it. So I went down, it was a $27 ticket. Well, I called from the precinct, I didn't call Humpy, I called a guy named Higgins. He was the writer for the Charlotte Observer. Next thing I know, it was headlined. And it actually turned into a high-speed chase. He didn't tell the whole story. The way it was written is that they chased me into an all-girls high school parking lot, and they found me playing basketball in the women's gym. That was the whole story. And so they asked me about it. I said, none of that's true. And I said, look, Willy T. Rivers doesn't know how to play basketball. Ask anyone. I said, however, the Willy T. Rivers, if that actually was true, he'd been having sex with the basketball coach. They didn't like that, and I knew it, so that's why I said. And so, that it was helping put a lot of hot sauce on that. And with Pruitt, when I went into the cockpit to get Pruitt, actually I hit him with my right hand, but as I was going in, my forearm hit the girl as I was going in to get him. Mm-hmm. I don't hit women. Never have. Never gonna. If I'm gonna get into it, it's gonna be with a man. And so those are some things that. And Bruce Jenner, he got out of the car. It was Bruce Jenner then, right? It wasn't Kevin.
Yeah, right.
And I got out of the car and I was walking back to my car. We're in the parking lot now. This is off the racetrack. And he comes and walking towards me. And I said, Jenner, I said, you mean this? He said, you can't get in the car now. I said, well, I said, you threw a spear in the Olympics, didn't you? Yeah. I said, you come any closer, I'm gonna put that spear up your ass sideways. That's exactly right. And I don't know if he had an envision of a spear going up his ass sideways, but it'd be a hell of a stretch.
I have to do a show at the Keswick Theater tonight, which is, I don't know what time it is, but...
I don't know how we are on time, but the stories have been great.
No, I love the stories. I just have to go. I have to do a show tonight at 7 o'clock at the Keswick, so I have to excuse myself.
Well, and I think they're going to eat or something. I don't know. Where's our director?
We don't have to break up the party because of me.
We're gonna break for food, and then we're gonna do a Q&A after everyone gets a bite to eat.
And when do we break for food?
Whenever you guys, gentlemen, are ready.
Give them a little more time. You got another 20 minutes.
Okay.
We'll take another 10 minutes.
I have to excuse myself because I gotta do a show. It was a pleasure.
It was great meeting you.
Great honor. And I'm glad I have those Oldsmobile cutlasses. You ever want to come by Glendale?
Yeah, come by and say hi.
Yeah, yeah,
well, I have to send you. I still have the original sketches out.
Yes, send them by or come by.
Yeah, I'll send you.
Come by and see them because I have both of them.
Okay.
So.
No, I'd love to do that.
Yeah, anytime. Yeah.
Great meeting you.
Nice to meet you.
Here.
Willy, we'll see you soon, brother.
All right. Take care.
You tested Formula One.
Yeah, Bernie Ecclestone is 90 years old now, and he's got a two-year-old son. No, that's no joke. He's got a two-year-old son named Ace. And when he sold Formula One a few years ago, he said, I'm going to be a daddy again. And I asked him, I said, why? He said, well, I've got a bunch of daughters and I haven't had a son yet. And he finally got it. So when I met Bernie in England in 1977 in Formula Ford, we always stayed in contact. And he never said no. And as a matter of fact, Mr. Carolla, when he called, Adam said, do you think Bernie will do an interview? Will you think he would be interviewed for the film? I said, of course he will. And Adam didn't believe it. So I'll bet you 25 cents he won't. So I emailed Bernie in London, and I got a message back the next day. And it was yes. And Adam said to me, he said, how did you do that? I said, I'll send you the email. Well, in the email, I said to Bernie Ecclestone, I said, before, as you recall, Mr. E, and that's what I called him, Lewis Hamilton is in Formula One and he's a world champion. He said, you put the first black man in a Formula One car, there's only been two. I said, how many people know that? And I said, that must be part of your legacy, that you made history in Formula One, that you made that happen. And I got that email back. He says, when do you want to do it? And so I said, June 17th. He said, be in my office at 11. So I sent Adam the email, and he was like, long away. And Bernie's been, yeah, he was special. And he had me over there, and going from a Trans Am car to a Formula One car, it would be like getting out of a 747 and getting into an F-16. That's the difference. It's night and day. I mean, not just in terms of power, because at the time when I drove the Brabham BMW, it had 1,100 horsepower.
Yeah.
1,100 horsepower.
Yeah.
And the problem with that is there was no gradual power gain. It was either on or it was off. Now, the V6 turbos, they had a smooth power batch, like rolling on and with that four-cylinder BMW.
Yeah, that's exactly. That's 1,000 horsepower from a four-cylinder motor.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So, when I got to Portugal, Nelson Piquet, who is Brazilian, and I know Nelson forever, because he was in England racing Formula 3 when I was there, Formula 4. He said, Vivi, the cars are very difficult. He said, you make sure when you step on the power, you have the car in a straight line. and he was looking at me, and he had a smile on his face, but he was serious, right? And he was right. I mean, when it went just like that, right? And the wheel, you could spin the on cold tires, you could spin the tires in fifth gear.
Jeez.
So, but the most amazing thing about driving a Formula One car was how well it stops. If any of you watch in-car cameras, in Formula One Grand Prix. Watch how far they go into the corner at 200 miles per hour before they put on the brakes. They get right to the corner and then put on the brakes instead of breaking back 100 yards or 150 yards. They can go right to the corner, and it goes from 215 miles per hour down to 55 in about 1,001, 1,002, 1,003.
That's it. And back then, the cockpit was way forward in the car, wasn't it?
No, I think we were pretty much centered.
Now,
in some of the cars with the big turbos, especially the Renaults.
The Renaults,
I mean, the driver's feet were right in the front end of the car.
Yeah.
I mean, you better not auger that thing in, because you were going to be hurt if you did. And so, but Gordon Murray, you know, built and designed a well-balanced car. And so and at that time, it was all carbon fiber. They had just started going all carbon fiber and moving from aluminum. But it was you knew, and what was equally amazing is how professional. I mean, you had the Italians on the tires, which was Pirelli, right?
So
you got Italian engineers, you had the English engineers on the chassis, and you had the German engineers on the BMW, right? So you would go from one debriefing, right? First of all, let's talk to Gordon Murray and Herbie Glash on the chassis, right? Then you go into the BMW trailer and talk to the Germans about the power issue and what. And they were really methodical. I see why Mercedes is just incredible.
Right.
Because they, no emotion, just numbers. What do you think? We're going to do this. And they tell you exactly what they're going to do and what to expect, right? And then of course, the tire guys, you didn't talk to them much. All they were doing was just taking tire pressures and temperatures.
Wow.
But it's everything. Formula One is everything you can imagine and more. It's just the flow of it, the technology, and what you can learn.
Well, I got to tell you, I feel honored to have been able to spend some time with you and ask you, you know, as I'm driving home tonight, I'll be thinking, I should have asked him this, I should have asked him that. After we break for food, for a meal, you'll be able to answer some of those questions that I didn't think of.
Well, Q&A, I really enjoy Q&A, so don't be bashful. When you come back after you've had a couple of drinks, make sure you have a couple of drinks. Bobby Unser would be handing you drinks.
Okay, we're going to take a break.
Yeah,
all right? Thank you.